Welcome to Wireless Future. This is episode 18. I'm Erik Larsson, and I'm here as always with my colleague Emil Björnsson. Hello, Emil. How are you today?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. Today we are delighted to have as guest Dr. Magnus Frodigh from Ericsson. Magnus is a vice president and head of Ericsson Research, heading up an organization of more than 700 staff researchers. He has a doctorate from KTH, Royal Institute of Technology in Stockholm, and he's been in the wireless field for more than 25 years, and is also an adjunct professor at KTH in Stockholm. Magnus, we are delighted to have you with us on the show. Thank you very much for joining.
Yes, and thank you for inviting me. I'm really looking forward to the podcast here.
That's great. So the plan is that Emil and I will run a conversation with you, and we'll ask you questions and hopefully not give you too a hard time along the way. And as a starting point, we are going to take the white paper that Ericsson published on 6G, Ever-Present Intelligent Communication, a Research Outlook Towards 6G. So my first question is, what are the driving forces behind 6G, and specifically what are the emerging applications that we will see that necessitates 6G? I mean, do we need, air quotes, 6G, and if so, for what?
It is really still in research phase, this, of course, and trying to beforehand to pinpoint sort of the killer application for something has always been difficult. So what we have been doing is a little bit looking now at the launch of 5G and what we believe will be developed and tried and start to get momentum in 5G, and then trying to think about how that could scale then in 2030 time frame, and 6G will kick in and really make this cost-effective services available for all sort of consumers and industries. So that's our starting point. And then if you do that, I think it's interesting to think about how the sort of the social media, entertainment, everything today, which is very much sort of screen-based, how that will evolve. And here we see and believe that we will have very, very good device development. So we will all have the possibilities to use AR glasses within a few years. And when you then can be sort of a little bit moving in between the physical world and the digital world and have all of this at the same time, I think this Internet of Senses is something that would really be one of the key applications.
Yeah, that's really exciting with the Internet of Senses, and also with emerging AR and VR applications, right? Which presumably would impose entirely new requirements also on the connectivity in terms of, well, latency requirements for one thing. I mean, if you're sitting with VR or glasses, then you probably need like a millisecond round trip guaranteed not to get motion sick, right? And not to mention the data rates, of course. So who is going to pay for this? I mean, who will finance the development? Will it be the I mean, in the end, the customers will pay, right? But during the development, will it be the operators or the consumer somehow, or someone else, or do we know that?
Yeah, the good thing is, of course, that we are sort of an established industry with large players, and the companies now sort of that have developed 4G and selling 4G, we use that in order to be able to develop 5G. And now hopefully we will be able to sell and deploy a lot of 5G infrastructure during the coming 10 years here. And then, of course, we will continuously invest in the continuation of this technology. And I mean, now when we are rolling out 5G in the first phase, it is the consumers that are driving that investment by the operator, because they are using more and more data. They want like to have more and more capacity. The operators are seeing that they get into capacity limits, so they need to invest in the network. Mm. And then you can, of course, do more 4G, or you can switch over to 5G. And then it gets more sort of attractive to switch over to 5G to get all of that functionality and get to the latest, newest equipment. Mm. And by that, you can also have savings when it comes to energy consumption and how you maintain and operate the networks, right? So we have this modernization going on, which sort of makes you need to buy new equipment, and then of course you buy the latest. Then it would be very, very interesting to see how the enterprise business would take off now on 5G. Is it so that the second phase of 5G will be very much driven from industries, enterprises, society that would like to have all of this functionality? And then 6G, then that might be when we take it back to consumers, right? Everybody wants the robots and stuff, right? And you really get into the consumer market again. Yeah, that might be.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at other businesses than consumers, indeed, or the consumer market indeed has been driving, right? I mean, think of like graphics cards for computers, which have been driven to a great extent by gaming, and now of course later on by machine learning applications that uses the same sort of circuitry, right? But this is the interesting aspect.
So one thing that comes to my mind is also sometimes I read that people claiming in the news that the first phase of 5G isn't really the 5G that we were looking for, because 5G is mostly for enterprises, right? This is just some soft version that is not really the real thing. What is your take on that? Is that a misunderstanding? If 5G is both for consumers and for enterprises?
Yeah, I think I definitely think this is the real thing, right? And as I said, it is for consumers now, firstly, because you get the better sort of performance. And looking at the countries that has been investing and made nationwide deployments, like Korea or something, then they have a huge uptake, right, of the subscriptions, the amount of data that they are using, and the kind of experiences that could be offered. But it's still sort of a little bit in the smartphone era, right? Mm-hmm. So it will take a little bit before we can take this step into this augmented reality glasses and new ways of interacting and everything. And then it will, of course, continue to be very consumer-driven, although we see a lot of these industry use cases. Hmm. So that's a good thing with this. This dual use of the technology, I think that's really the fundament here to get the big impact in society also on the sort of non-consumer side. Hmm.
Yeah, I think this is a good point that even if we get new use cases, it doesn't mean that the old ones will not evolve and continue to be important. Mm. So one of the things you are mentioning in the white paper as a goal for future development is something called limitless connectivity. What does that mean more precisely?
Yeah, this could be a challenge from a pure sort of scientific point of view, of course. But what we really mean is that the connectivity provided will be ahead of the needs. You will sort of have the connectivity that you would need and expect in different situations. And there will be then limitations, perhaps, of what you can do, how the applications develop, what kind of compute you will have, etc., etc. But it should not really be this limitation by the data rate or the available capacity or something like that. That should be enough for what you could expect and need. And then we all know that there are, of course, limitations on how to provide that in extremely wide areas. But also there we are trying to get sort of more data rate, more capacity to larger areas. And there is a lot of development to have an integration with the satellite industry to really get sort of full coverage, right? And it's still a little bit questions around exactly how the devices would look like. If it's so that you can buy a standard phone and a smartphone and then pay a little bit extra to get the satellite subscription on top, or if it needs to be a separate antenna or a special phone or something. We don't really know yet exactly how that could be done.
So achieving some kind of global coverage with wireless, is it that it's not economically feasible to build out cellular networks everywhere and therefore you need to fill in with Starlink and other technologies from the sky? Or is it that it's really not possible to provide global coverage from the ground?
I think overseas, I guess it's sort of overseas, that it will be a challenge.
That's a good point.
If you're on the land-based, I think we have a lot of technology, and we see how the 2G networks have been built out to 90% plus something population coverage, but the LTE networks are not yet as built out. So to just put LTE base stations on all your GSM base station sites would provide a lot of value and a lot of data to these developing countries, right, where the coverage still is poor. So just using the technology we have, and then what is limiting then typically is you get into these backhaul problems and energy provide the needed energy, etc. So you need solar cells, obviously, and so on. Perhaps a satellite can offer a very interesting backhaul opportunity here. Perhaps that's the key application actually for satellite communication, to provide affordable connectivity to really, really rural areas.
That's an interesting point with the satellite connectivity. So if we continue to talk about challenges, I mean, the white paper also talks about challenges that 5G cannot meet, right? And we mentioned a few here. I think this unlimited coverage is one, and also support for emerging consumer applications like virtual reality, especially, is another one. What other challenges are there, or rather use cases, that 5G was never able to support? I mean, to my understanding, 5G is excellent for mobile broadband service, but it never really succeeded on supporting ultra reliable low latency communications, for example. It only partly succeeded on massive MTC and massive access. Is that a correct understanding, and are there other challenges that you see that 5G wasn't able to really meet?
Yeah, I think it's a bit early to say exactly what 5G will be able to meet and not meet, because we have just the first now commercial networks being rolled out, the current limitation, I think, for most non mobile broadband type of applications are that we need more sort of industry devices. So we need more device capabilities, and then I'm sure that we will be able to do. If LTE is reasonably getting down to 20 millisecond round trip times, if you have a good setup, everything, perhaps 5G will do 5 milliseconds to start with, and then we will gradually optimize that, and we have all the millimeter waves where we can go even lower in the round trip latencies over the air interface. And then if you combine that with on-prem compute, etc., then I think we could reach this 1 millisecond. So there is a lot of built-in possibilities to develop 5G, and that's the, we have really been thinking about that in the design, that everything that one device needs should be confined into that antenna beam, so to say, and that device should not listen to anything else, right? That means that you can add another sort of version of 5G on top in the same, right? And that will not confuse the already existing devices. And by that, there's a lot of sort of forward compatibility possibilities built in here. So now we're starting up standardization here for something that will be called 5G Advanced, which is sort of release 18, which we are able then to add a few things that we will now see that might be missing. But what I think we, perhaps something a little bit more fundamental that is not fully covered, where I would expect there would be gaps, that's in this robustness to really make it resilient against attacks, etc. So you can really provide these mission critical services that will be everything. You will be so dependent on these, right? So there, I think on this trustworthiness, resiliency, there I think there are gaps that we need to address.
Yeah, when you say resilience against attacks, do you mean like jamming attacks on the physical layer, or do you mean other types of attacks that the system could be subject to?
Yeah, I mean both, I think. Just to buy a jammer on the internet, and that's sort of easy. And if you then have sort of the traffic in the city and the traffic in the crossing there controlled, and you just turn on one of these jammers and you can have a standstill of all traffic, right? That will not really be acceptable. So there it's a lot of needs, I think. And then, of course, you need to be resilient to more sort of classical attacks as well. And you need to have some sort of separation. You really need to treat these systems as critical. And you need to have well thought through backups or safety modes of the systems. It has to be, something needs to always be upright. Even under some circumstances of attacks, etc., you really need to keep some basic service, I think. Otherwise, too much will be at stake, I think.
Right, that's such an important point, I think, with the resilience against attacks. And one thing to remember here also is that equipment for jamming of wireless links and systems used to be military grade and cost, I mean, millions of dollars, right? If you back up to, I don't know, a couple of, or a few decades, say. But the same technology is available today off the shelf. I mean, you can buy a software-defined radio for $1,000 over the internet and in principle start transmitting in any of the bands that are used for commercial mobile radio, or even for critical infrastructure applications. And obviously, that's a significant threat to society when we rely on these systems for critical tasks.
Yeah. So, and we really would like to have then with a multitude of advanced antenna capabilities, we would like to be able to identify jammers, be able to sort of work around them in order to protect the system.
Right. And of course, I mean, jamming is just the simplest form of an attack, right? Where you, as an intentional jammer, transmits a noise-like signal in order to disrupt or block the communications of others. But there are also a lot more sophisticated attacks. Spoofing, for example, where you pretend that you are a legitimate base station and try to connect to users in the cell and send them fake information or eavesdrop on them and so forth. So these are definitely great challenges. It has been for a long time, in my view, as you probably know, and it's also extremely reassuring to hear you talking about this with us now.
Yeah. Yes, I think it's interesting. And some of these things that we had on these false space stations, I think that has been addressed. But I think the requirements when it comes to privacy and protection of not only your sort of phone number identity. Now, when Internet of Senses type of applications, this will be all your private life, right? That right. needs to be protected. And then I think the locality of data and having regulation around this, et cetera, is a huge area that we need to work on.
That's the other side of it, right, with the privacy and who owns the data, where does the data sit and so forth. But again, back to the threat of jamming and perhaps even spoofing, that today electronics is so cheap and you could think of an adverse or hostile actor who would buy swarms of drones and send them up in the air and have each drone transmit, doesn't have to be a very strong signal, I mean, but you could easily disrupt or shut down the wireless coverage over a whole city, right? So these are frightening prospects, indeed, I believe, and something that definitely will have to be addressed in future research and development. Great. So, Emil, I think you want to talk about data rates.
Yes, and first just remind about one of the, I think, great thing that you were also pointing out, that we are often so focused on there is 5G and then there is 6G, like there is nothing happening through 10 years apart from research. But as you were also mentioning, there are many releases in between, and we shouldn't judge what 5G can and cannot do based on only the first generations. And I guess in order to point that out more clearly to the public, you also are introducing these names like 5G Advanced, and maybe there will be a 5G Advanced Pro or something like that later on. Anyway, what I wanted to ask about was a bit this with the data traffic that is growing. So Ericsson have this mobility report coming out once or twice per year, talking about how the data traffic is growing. And if I look back to sort of the research leading up towards 5G, I remember maybe it was 2013 or so, both Qualcomm and Nokia were talking about that we think that the data traffic in the future will double every year. So at 10 years, that's 1,000 times increase. And then now, if you look in your report, it's more like 45% increases. And then when I try to break that down into different countries, I get the impression at least that if you look in developing countries, they might have 60-70% increase there, which is natural because they sort of come in with LTE technology now, as you were also mentioning. And then in developed countries, it might be slightly less than 45 then to get that average. So do you see that we will continue having an exponential growth like this for the coming decades? Or are we seeing some kind of convergence where everyone cannot stream more than HD video quality all the time, so if once you reach that, you saturate?
Yeah, it's I definitely think this will continue, and I expect it to accelerate. First of all of this sort of mobile broadband type of services will be, we will go from this screen of today to 360 video, audio, etc. And we will have holograms, etc. It takes enormous data rates. So that's one development. The other thing is all these machines, which a lot of the machines will be very capable, right? And they will carry AI capabilities. So they will be intelligent machines. And these machines can communicate then with other intelligent machines. And how much an AI to AI type of communication, how much data they can generate and consume, there's no limitations on that, I think. So I think we will see the growth of yet another leg of usage here, which could be of equal size, I think.
So it's more like that we have sort of natural fluctuations over time based on what kind of new devices have been showing up at a particular time. So now we might be waiting for this AR, XR kind of device to show up.
Yeah, perhaps we are limiting it or approaching some limit on how much you can consume by a screen. Perhaps that is what you see there. And when we break that, it will take a new development then. I would assume. And then you could argue that now it's a lot of talk about the data, the user data plane, but I think the control plane of this system would be perhaps not the same amount of data, but that will increase in importance. So guarantee certain behaviors, have the observability, predictability, the robustness of everything, right? So there is a lot of metadata around the data, I think, that will be of very large importance here going forward.
Eric, did you have some further questions?
Yeah, I'd like to talk about technology solutions that we see coming, let's say in 5G advanced or 5G advanced plus or 6G in any case for the future, right? And the obvious ones that I can think of right off the bat obviously are larger MIMO arrays and higher carrier frequencies, right? I mean, millimeter wave is already there, but there's a lot of talking about terahertz and also about visible light. And what is your view on this, Magnus? What are the most important new technologies that we will see forthcoming in, say, the next 10 or even 20 years?
I think we haven't really yet understand the full potential or limitations of the millimeter wave equipment. So when we get that right, we will see what that means. And these systems will provide a lot of capacity because they need to be denser and there is huge spectrum bands available. So these are extremely interesting. And then a question is, of course, would that just scale then if you take that even higher in frequency? Or will you be even more limited on line of sight and these kind of things? Mm. So I'm very interested in your particular fields here around the distributed MIMO. So if these kind of solutions could actually mitigate a little bit all of these drawbacks that you are blocked from different directions, etc., and that you can get the signal through by this distributed MIMO schemes. So that's one of my favorite technologies, actually. Mm.
Yeah, mine as well, and I think also Emil's, right?
So, yeah, sure.
I mean, it seems clear that terahertz, millimeter wave, or even terahertz is attractive because of the enormous bandwidths available there, right? At the same time, the problems that we see at millimeter wave will just be even further aggravated when we move up to terahertz. The problem with path loss, or more accurately, the effective area of an antenna element, which translates into a loss in or reduction in path loss, and the problems with blocking, the fact that we'll have increasingly line of sight propagation, and also the loss in channel coherence, right, which increases the difficulties in tracking the channel and obtaining channel state information for beamforming, particularly. So, speaking of MIMO technology, where do you see that heading? I mean, you mentioned distributed MIMO, right? Where we think of arrays, we distribute the antennas further apart, so the distance between every antenna is a lot larger than, say, a wavelength. I guess that's the definition of distributed MIMO. Or in some forms that we build panels, and the panels might comprise, well, 10 or 20 or 50 maybe antennas, and they might be separated by half a wavelength or one wavelength or something, and then we have multiple panels that in turn are separated by many meters or even tens or hundreds of meters apart. So that's distributed MIMO. There are also visions of building extremely large scale arrays, covering, for example, the face of a high-rise skyscraper outdoors and so forth. I think I had in some publication or talk an example where we looked at, okay, so if we are outdoors and at 2 gigahertz band, say, and we had the opportunity to cover a skyscraper with antennas, then how many antennas could ever be useful, right? And the answer that we concluded was that, well, the channel coherence, if there are lots of people there who want, say, virtual reality type of service, right, and they are standing still, then channel coherence might be, say, 200 milliseconds. The channel coherence bandwidth is 200 kilohertz. 200 times 200 is 40,000, which means that we have room for 40,000 orthogonal pilots, which means that we can, in principle, multiplex 40,000 terminals simultaneously, which means that we need 40,000 antennas, right? And, well, 40,000 antennas would actually fit on the facade of a skyscraper. So now, this is a vision, not science fiction, I think. It's still within the boundaries of what physics and information theory tells us is possible. But what is your view, Magnus? I mean, distributed MIMO, I think we seem to be in agreement all three, right, that it's coming and it's obviously a highly promising and useful technology. But these extreme large-scale arrays outdoors then, I think, would be the main deployment case. Is that something that we see on the horizon, or is it, say, for industry, more of science fiction?
Yeah, I think it's a little bit of a question of what kind of problems we are trying to solve. And typically, when we are looking at systems and how they are getting more and more loaded and more users more and more traffic, most people tend to be indoor.
Mm.
Actually, 80% or something is indoor. So people are typically indoor.
Mm. Yeah, I can resonate with that, of course. On the other hand, you can think of applications where, you know, a big square in a big city where you have tens of thousands of people, right, who want to simultaneously enjoy virtual reality, or a sports stadium where if you don't want to watch the soccer game directly, you want to enjoy it through a device or something. Who knows what the next generation teenagers will want to do, right? And on top of that, there is, of course, also might be applications with extreme reliability requirements that require the use of very large arrays, because to achieve reliability, then either we need more bandwidth to get diversity, or we need more antennas to get diversity, or we need more time to get diversity, right? So, but I definitely can see your reservations here too. So what would be the applications where this really would be useful? On the other hand, once a technology is there, then applications tend to emerge. So it might be a somewhat provocative example to talk about 40,000 antennas on a skyscraper, but anyways.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, let's see. But to have a much denser installation of more existing type of panels, and then try to connect them into some distributed scheme in order to avoid, or so you can handle all the interference and everything, because you get everything line of sight, right? So I think that's the good promise by these distributed MIMO schemes, that you can build denser and denser and denser and still sort of get higher and higher capacity out of it, which is a challenge, really, right?
Right, so that is the main pathway that you are seeing in terms of how MIMO technology will evolve, that will be building distributed MIMO systems consisting of, say, panels, or, well, let's call them panels, that in themselves are smaller mid-sized antenna arrays, but they are then mutually interconnected and can operate coherently together and achieve all the benefits that come with that. That's a vision that I think, I share, of course, and I think Emil also shares it.
Yeah, so, I just wrote this book that we talked about a few episodes before, about cell-free massive MIMO, as we often call it in academia. So if I understand correctly, when it comes to deploying many antennas at one location, I used to think that it's sort of the physical size that was limiting us, in terms of that typical places on rooftops and in towers, you cannot fit more antennas than a certain number, because then it becomes too heavy or too big. But you also mean that you might not, there is also an upper limit on the what might be useful at a particular site, because of the sort of coverage area that it could serve.
Yeah, I think I think it's attractive to go up in frequency to millimeter wave, because then these panels that we talk about will be small, right? And they will have very attractive form factor, and you can have many of them. But you need to get a little bit closer to the users, because you are a little bit line of sight limited in these. And that, I think, will drive a different type of deployments. Complementing, then, we will still have the rooftop of course, and that will evolve. I'm not saying that we will keep the same solutions we have today. That will evolve, and it might be 10 times of what we have today, etc. But the real breakthrough, I think, is more on this closer to the users, into indoor environments, etc. And then you can't bring the big panels and the big output power that we have today. Then it needs to look different.
So if we talk about like performance metrics that could be important in the future, I guess the classical ones are sort of like data rates per user and how it varies in the coverage area and the capacity per cell and the latency. And then maybe, I guess if from 5G, the IMT 2020 is also talking about energy efficiency. Will this be the main performance metrics of importance going forward, or do you think something new will appear and that ITU will put requirements on some new performance metric for something to be called a 6G technology?
Question how broadly ITUR will look at this, if they will sort of stay in the frequency receiver air interface type of domains, or if they would take a broader look at this, or if it will be other industry bodies defining sort of the broader picture. Because this is what you can see in front of you is really this integrated system where you have compute, you have connectivity, and you have that very, very distributed. And on top of that, you have a lot of AI, automation, data-driven capabilities. And then you have this sort of robustness, trustworthiness in all of these different aspects. So there's a lot of requirements in this. How to integrate with the compute, how to provide, so it's data-driven and fully automized, and how it can then can provide the needed level of trustworthiness. And we see this already when we are doing our research in the HexaX project, for example, where we are looking at the potential requirements on the 6G. Then it's much broader than it used to be. So we are adding this next circle of requirements on top of the classical ones, definitely.
I would suppose that also new use cases will bring the need for entirely new performance indicators, right? Possible application of wireless networks is for, as we spoke earlier, for machines to communicate and perhaps have edge devices that collaborate in training some machine learning model that resides in the cloud. And most of the traffic would then be comprised of like model updates in the form of some gradient of a parameter vector or something. And that's a whole different type of traffic as compared to bits that we are used to for video transmission or file downloads or anything else, more or less. Is that a reasonable view to hold that there will be a need for like completely new types of performance metrics because of these new applications that we see emerge?
Yeah, I think so too. If a machine then are looking at a camera or a video stream, right, that would need a different, completely different coding schemes in order to do the job. And if you want to watch a football game, right, that's very, very different. So that will require new technology and new requirements, and the performance measures, yes, they will be different.
Going back to this thing with frequency band, but thinking more broadly about it, I think something that I sometimes hear when people say, oh, this phase one 5G isn't really 5G because 5G was supposed to be about millimeter wave, right? And we barely have that yet. So to what extent will millimeter be the main thing in 5G when we look back 10 years from now? Or is it like an additional thing that we use in some special cases? And what does that potentially tell us about 6G? Are we moving up in frequency for real, or are we just adding extra frequencies in higher bands in certain specific scenarios?
Now, to start with, it's very clear that this is a 3.5 gigahertz band, which is really kicking in and giving operators significantly more capacity compared to what they have, because they can use the MIMO technology, they get sort of 100 megahertz band, and they can put that on their existing site, basically, right?
Hmm.
So that's what's happening now, and that's, of course, extremely good. The question is then if this we will start to build this more dedicated networks, indoor networks, sort of city centers, stadiums, stations, airports, etc., on the millimeter wave. And if you start to build these and that gets some momentum, then of course that will increase in importance. And if we have created all of these sites, then of course it might be so that we are ready to go up even higher in frequency, and we have the foundation then for taking the step to 6G and perhaps sort of add a little bit of these things that we didn't fully understood when we started up this development of the millimeter waves. So that could be one development. But there are operators now building millimeter wave, right? So, so it is starting, and we have this street macro cells that they're using, etc. So yeah, something is happening.
So I guess the 3.5 or even lower will always be sort of important for the coverage, but do you think the bulk of the traffic will go in millimeter wave bands 10 years from now?
I think this infrastructure thing is a slow process. So in 10 years, I think we will be dominated by the 3.5 band. What operators now are installing, giving them, it gives them sort of 5-10 times the capacity they have today, basically, right? So they will use that, and then they will reform their lower bands in order to get on modern 5G equipment, so have 4G, 5G in some sort of combination. And then they will, over time now, complement millimeter wave, but that will go slower. So I don't think that will dominate yet if you look at 2030. It's always a risky thing to talk about 2030, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, but
So when it comes to this millimeter wave deployments, I mean, we were mentioning indoor scenarios and street macro, and these are sort of the occasions where we don't lack connectivity today. We might be using Wi-Fi in our home or offices, and I've experienced places like Luxembourg or Vancouver where you have outdoor Wi-Fi covering the streets. So to some extent, millimeter wave here is targeting use cases where you become more closely a competitor towards Wi-Fi technology. So what are the main benefits of using 5G compared to, say, Wi-Fi?
Yeah, you are perfectly right that there's an overlap here. And Wi-Fi has an enormously large ecosystem, and there is devices available, etc. So I think Wi-Fi is here to stay. That's not something we're trying to replace in any way. So looking now at our offerings, if you were to look at the Ericsson 5G private networks that we have started now to package, a little bit smaller networks that could be then deployed for some dedicated purpose, if you are able to work together with an operator, or if you have a local license or something like that, then I think we are starting to look at a little bit more wider area. It could be a port, it could be an airport, it could be a larger factory area or something like that, right? And there I think we can have a system where we can offer mobility, reliability, predictiveness in a way that is really appreciated by these customers. And they have tried Wi-Fi there, and they haven't had that great experience. So there I think we are able to offer something which is competitive. Then over time, it might be so that the millimeter wave equipment here are getting more and more sort of lower cost, and they get an ecosystem around that. And perhaps you can buy your own 5G at home system. I don't know. I would like to have one, but that might be a few years out, right? But we have this integrated access backhaul, so you could put up a unit, right, which communicate with 5G as a backhaul link then, and then in that, in your local area, you can have the 5G access, and so I can imagine that also will compete on the market.
Yeah, and I've noticed myself, whenever you use Wi-Fi and you start to move around, even just walk out from your office or try to use the street Wi-Fi, it doesn't really work as soon as you start moving around. So I guess really the service quality would be much better with this type of technologies. One thing that I also noticed was that I think there was a lot of like Ericsson 4G base stations that could be upgraded to run 5G software or run it in parallel with 4G. Is this part of some kind of wider trend where the connectivity becomes more software defined, where we might see maybe even in mobile phones that we will get a software upgrade that allows us to support the next release, or will it still be that the hardware will dictate what kind of 5G or 6G that you can utilize?
I think this definitely is something that we were able to introduce now, and it's even more advanced than that you can use the same hardware. You can use the same spectrum at the same time, right? And you can on a millisecond level decide if this time slot is for a 4G or for a 5G user, right? And you can mix all of that. And that gives, of course, very, very nice upgrade possibilities for operators. You don't need to do this sort of clean the spectrum band in order to shift technology. You can do that gradually as your customers are upgrading their devices. You can sort of gradually shift over to the new technology. So that's extremely interesting. And I would assume that that's a requirement that will be in all updates going forward, that you can do this. That would be my expectation.
So to what extent do you actually get better service, and to what extent do you just get the 5G logo in the corner of your screen when you're sort of switching? I mean, if it's the same hardware, is it the software that just makes the difference?
Yeah, I guess what we have been able to do now with our equipment is that we have been able to use the same sort of digital unit, the sort of baseband processing capability, etc. And that has been flexible enough in order then to use it for 4G or 5G in this way, so we can have this common scheduler that could sort of directly then decide on what systems to be transmitted. And if you get the new system going, right, and your phone is capable of it, then you will get the advantages of the new system, right? But the hardware that you have already in the base stations, that's of course still the previous generation capacity when it comes to amount of users or the maximum data rate it can handle, etc. So you will need to upgrade that, obviously, but you don't need to do it all at once. You can turn it on and you can get sort of the 5G logo on the phone, and then the first users buying the 5G phones can experience it. And then you get the market going, you get customers that would like to have more data, they would like to sort of pay for the subscriptions, and then you can gradually upgrade. So it's a more attractive way of introducing a new system, basically. But of course, if you want gigabits and a capacity, you need to have the corresponding horsepower on the base station side as well, obviously.
Eric, do you want to take the next question?
Absolutely. So returning to the white paper, it talks about network compute fabric. And what is that really? I mean, is that a way of saying centralized or cloud RAN, or is it something else? Or is it a way of saying, well, distributed MIMO, right, where you have panels that are interconnected and operate together and constitute some sort of computing fabric? Or what does this term really mean, network compute fabric?
Yeah, I think you can... There will be a lot of compute needed, right? And in order to have the low latencies, the applications needs to run closer to the devices, right? So there is definitely a trend from central clouds to more distributed cloud, and you will have more edge capabilities, so to say. So the compute is moving out. And then you would, of course, have the radio network as such, and all the baseband processing could use this compute, obviously. So then the network will itself use it. Mm. But more importantly, I think, is that the applications will be running out there further out. And when we talk about the network compute fabric, it's really more from this application point of view. So if you have you want to do an AR experience, something, and you don't have a graphical card in the glasses, right? So you need to have that then on the network side, but you need to just render the picture out what you should see on these glasses, right? Then you realize that there is a huge sort of delay requirements there, and a lot of data, a lot of capacity that needs to be provided. So when you start to see that you have these compute capabilities, different dedicated hardware, CPUs, GPUs, or whatever, right, out there, and then you have this connectivity, and then you have data available somewhere, you have storage available somewhere. It's almost like that you would like to jointly optimize this and view this as in one operating system, where you can jointly then optimize the use of your compute, your storage, the location of the data, and your connectivity that you have available in order to change this situation, right? And that's really where we talk about this network compute fabric. So that's really the vision if you stretch it to the extreme. But before that, you will see the hyperscalers coming with edge compute, and you will see how the communication, the mobile broadband systems and the hyperscalers are meeting, and you will see sort of a richer and richer environment at the edge where you can sort of run applications taking advantage of all of the low latency capabilities that we provide.
So we see sort of like a merge between a supercomputer and the wireless network infrastructure there. I mean, where edge nodes and even antenna panels might have the capability to support devices with computation tasks, as you mentioned. I mean, you might be sitting with VR glasses that don't have an advanced enough graphics card, and then they ask for help from the network, and the actual computation would go in the network, but not necessarily in the cloud somewhere, but rather in the actual antenna panel, or at least in the wireless base station or that distributed MIMO system that's serving it, right? That's a fascinating prospect, I think. So returning to the theme of the conversation where we started with 6G, it seems increasingly so to me that 6G might not be necessarily a clean break with everything else that existed and a new design from a clean sheet, but rather something that evolves from 5G, right? I mean, you spoke earlier about 5G and 5G plus and 5G plus advanced and so on. What is the timeline for this? I mean, when will 5G have evolved into something that we can, with a clean conscious, call and sell as 6G?
Yeah. This is very, very open, exactly what will be the step here. And that's, of course, depends on how much the 5G evolves and when we get to this, that now we shouldn't call this an evolution anymore. Now it's really something different and so on. And the industry now is gearing up to this, and we are sort of expecting this to be the 10-year cycle. So in 2030, something should be ready, which should be called 6G. And if you count backwards, you realize that standardization of that needs to perhaps start 2025 or something. And hopefully then the ITU process goes on in parallel, and we are able to set reasonable requirements, and they will get some new interesting spectrum, and then we will do it all over again, so to say, just every 10 years. Will it then be different? All good ideas that we have on the 6G research, which could be implemented on 5G, will be, I think, that then they will, 5G will just absorb them, right, and say, yeah, this is possible to do with 5G, let's do it, and there will be a market for that. And then if this, what remains to be 6G, then gets smaller and smaller because everything is sort of pushed to 5G, then the step will be small, right? But if it's so that we see that this, you want to have it data-driven in a different way, you want, instead of having a lot of domain knowledge being implemented in the product design, it will be a set of learned models that is out there, right? That might be such a fundamental shift in how you think about how building the hardware and software here, that you need to do a little bit from an implementation point of view. You need to do it differently. So it might be that really makes it 6G, right?
That's interesting. So, I mean, there's the standards and the way the standards evolves on one hand, right? And there is the evolution, say, of the implementation as a totally different and parallel thing. And I guess we're like folks like Emil and myself in academia like to think about visions, right? And 6G in terms of, well, if we were to like redesign a wireless system from a clean sheet, then what would it look like? And I mean, that sort of mentality. Whereas in industry, it's rather that, well, there's a lot of legacy, right, invested, and there's a lot of technology which has been extremely refined already. And then the mindset might be more of like, how do we continue to refine? And then it, in a way, becomes like more of a marketing question. I mean, when does 5G become 6G, right? I don't know, Emily, if you agree with this view, but it's kind of how I like to think about it.
Yeah, I think we often, like in academia, talk about revolutions, and then revolutions are happening. But they don't happen from one year to the next one. There is a continuous evolution, and then you look back and see, oh, this was actually a revolution. But I think this timeline that you were mentioning also, it fits very well. I guess we have students at various undergraduate or graduate level that are listening to this podcast, and if the standardization would start now in 4 years from now, they have plenty of time to study up on the topic and get involved and both at Ericsson or at other players to play a role in actually designing the new technology. So what do you think will be important for a student to learn in order to sort of take a relevant part in the development, to be employable at Ericsson, for example, to do research in this field? Is it the same as before, or is it changing?
I think there will be a lot of opportunities, and Ericsson and others will need a lot of new competence. So we are of course very, very interested in having a dialogue with students, and I'm sure that we'll be able to offer a lot of career possibilities, right? So what will then be needed in order to do that? And I think the field that the knowledge that we need is broadening. If it was a little bit more before, more focused on this communication theory, classical electrical engineering type of competences, it's broader now. It is more system thinking. It is more AI, of course, but that's just something we will need all over, right? So that's not unique for us. But the trustworthiness, the security thinking on that, but also how these technologies are used in different verticals. So more system thinking, more end-to-end understanding, and then of course to have the basic knowledges in the communications field is of course also key, right? But I don't think you should feel like you just need to have this exact profile or something. I think many different profiles will fit actually in the needs that we have going forward.
So what do you think we should tell our students to sort of convince them that the telecom industry isn't something that is a done deal, or everyone have a device now, it's over. There is more future development in self-driving cars or maybe some other space travel that they should invest their time in learning.
Yeah, but I think the communication technology or the networks here, they will enable all of these other things to happen, right? Nothing of all of this vision can happen unless they are connected and you can monitor and control them in a reliable way. So to being part of the telecom net system, the industry in a broad sense, I think you will be part of shaping the future and how we live There is a lot of contributions to society here, I think, that is, to me, it's extremely motivating. And it is also one of the key technologies for the sustainability and to reduce the climate emission, the CO2 emissions here, etc. So there are so many things that these technologies can enable. Then it's important to have all the good forces here, of course, to make sure that these technologies are used for good. We see, of course, examples where that's not the case, right? So it is really, we need everyone here joining this and contribute. And I think the technology is still an answer on a lot of our different problems that we need to address. So to me, it's extremely motivating to be part of this journey. And I think we have seen enormous development, but we have equally much ahead of us, I think.
Yeah, I mean, if wireless was only about transferring things to a mobile phone, now we are digitalizing the entire society. So it will be sort of a important component in every digital type of service that we'll have in the future. So Eric, did you have any more to say?
No, I just wanted to reinforce the point because it's so important, right? That communications is a fundamental enabler for almost anything else in the modern society. And it's reassuring to hear you also, Magnus, saying this, and to grad students, because I know that we have a lot of grad students listening to the show. There are great opportunities out here, and great opportunities not only for, let's say, hardcore research and development in communication technology, right, but also to have an impact on society. I think we are approaching the close-up here. I have a final discussion point where I would like to have your view, Magnus. And it's about the telecoms industry as such. Even when I was, say, younger or grew up in the field, then there were lots of other actors, right? I mean, we had Motorola, we had Alcatel-Lucent, we had Nortel, and so forth. Now there are only a few, let's say, remaining. And at the same time, we also see this trend with Open RAN and perhaps the potential for new smaller vendors to enter again. What are your reflections on this?
Yeah, we are seeing this in many or on this ICT technology industry, right? That there is the huge companies taking a more and more dominant position, and if you focus down in the infrastructure for mobile networks industry, then there is an extremely complex thing here, right? And it takes a lot of development. We are spending 40 billion crowns per year on investing in our R&D for this. And then, of course, you get scale advantages by that, and then you can invest even more. And that drives this concentration, which is sort of natural, I think.
Well, Yeah, it might be natural, and it's also seen in many other fields, right? I mean, take the airplane industry, for example. There is almost only Boeing and Airbus producing passenger jets, and I'm sure you can find many other examples. You can also find examples to the contrary. I think the car industry is a good example where we have a wide diversity of different brands, although they are in many cases owned by the same conglomerates. Right. But the real question here, I think, was whether Open RAN and that movement has a chance or the potential to make a break with what's going on. Do you think that we will see smaller vendors? Obviously, I mean, this is like asking, do you think we will see new competitors, right? But do you have a view on, or of course, it's always, as I always say, it's hard to predict the future, but do you have any final reflections on how you think that this Open RAN movement potentially could impact the way that the industry is structured and organized?
Yeah, I think it could have a big impact, and we are, as Ericsson, we are very active in to drive the O-RAN standardization work, right? And it could have impacts, of course, that you could mix and match a little bit to buy one part of the system from one vendor and another part from another vendor. Today we have the radio network and the core network type of split, right? But it could be perhaps one or two more of these interfaces that could be. Yeah, but there is a lot of innovation going on still, as you know, between the antenna system and the radio and the baseband, right? That is something that still evolves, and if you standardize that, you will have some basic functionality, but we and others will of course provide additional functionality on top of these interfaces that could provide advantages. Then I think if you look at how this network platform interacts with applications, I think that part of the O-RAN could make it more rich in how you could have APIs and data out of the networks into application field in a very interesting way, I think. So there are definitely opportunities to get it more richer. Then, of course, if you want to buy sort of a scheduler from a different vendors and so on, then I guess we, Ericsson, can't take an end-to-end responsibility anymore, right? Because that will be hard. And then, of course, we can take an integrator role. But then we have a prepackaged, already tested product ourselves, where we take full responsibility for, or you then mix and match, and then you need an integrator. And still, who do you call when it doesn't work?
Yeah. When it doesn't work. Yeah, that's an important point indeed, and also brings us back to what we spoke about earlier, right, with trustworthiness and so forth, and building systems that really work, guaranteed, all the time. Very good. I think with that, we are approaching the close-up here. So thank you very much, Magnus, for joining us on the show today. This has been a fun and educational conversation. I learned a lot. Thanks, Emil. I'm not sure, Emil, if you want to say something about the summer break that we plan for the podcast.
Yeah, so this is episode number 18, and also the last one for this first season, I would say, of our podcast. So we will take a summer break now and be back after the summer with a second season. So don't be afraid, we will be back. So thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. And to our listeners, as always, don't forget to like and subscribe us on YouTube, and see you again in the fall. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.